Introducing the revolutionary new Toyota Supra.
Oh! Is that a Supra?
Oh, sweet, my favorite song is on.
The Toyota Supra, it's kind of like your favorite porn star. Chances are, you can't get your hands on one now that they're famous, and it's great to fantasize and to lust about, but does it really live up to all the hype?
Thanks to my friends over at Northeast Auto Imports, I've been fortunate enough to drive some dream cars from the 1990s, including this 1993 Toyota Supra Turbo's direct competitor, the FD Mazda RX-7. And today, we're in what seems to be the king of the hill of 1990s Japanese sports car stardom, the A80 Supra, affectionately known here in America by the cool kids as the Mark IV.
The Toyota Supra Turbo A80 was produced between 1993 and ended in 2002, and it shows off perfectly what made Japanese sports cars of the 1990s contenders ready to take on any nation, and in many cases, beating the competition from Europe and America. And that hurts because I have a Corvette. This particular Supra Turbo is an import and has only 80,000 miles on it. It has the 6-speed manual transmission that everybody wants, and the most special bit about it, it's completely stock.
The Mark IV Supra, of course, came to fame in the movie The Fast and the Furious, where Paul Walker drove an orange 1993 Mark IV Supra, the same year as this one.
Now, of course,
get over here.
You can't talk about Toyota Supra without mentioning that combination of letters and numbers right afterwards. 2JZ GTE, the over-engineered power plant that propels this thing. Toyota released this big, tough iron block straight six after Nissan decided to shove their RB26 DETT engine into the GTR. Though the 2J got its start in a four-door sedan before making its name known being bolted into the chassis of a sport coupe, this 2JZ GTE, which is one of the nicest that you will see, which also happens to be bone stock and unmolested, is a 3-liter straight six injected with air by twin turbos, a smaller turbo to get you going and reduce lag, and a larger secondary to kick your ass in the top end. This engine is incredibly popular in the tuner world because it's basically extremely overbuilt. It's got a giant iron block and forged rods in that block. It can make a lot of power very easily and can handle massive amounts of it. It's now more common to see a Mark IV Supra with over 1,000 horsepower than to see one stock. It should have 700 or 800 horsepower, except for it didn't. This is an imported model, so it has 276 horsepower and 318 foot-pounds of torque to satisfy Japan's gentleman's agreement to not advertise higher horsepower ratings in order to try to minimize racing and car accidents.
Let's lie to them.
Okay.
Now the American model, on the other hand, well, that one produced 321 horsepower and 315 foot-pounds of torque. Now that 2JZ is connected to, as I said, this six-speed manual transmission, which is the most sought-after option for the Mark IV Supra, and the rarest, as most of these came as automatics. It's the extremely robust GetRag V160 transmission, which nowadays can fetch a pretty penny. I like this cool little shifter that you use to shift that transmission. That was redundant. It feels really nice to hold, and it's got stitching kind of like a baseball. I didn't play baseball. But what I like most about the Supra interior is how everything is faced towards the driver. This car is very driver focused, and you know it the second that you sit down in it. This whole center stack is angled towards the driver. It's like the cockpit of a fighter jet. It's so driver orientated, it's like a big F you to the passenger. You are worthless. That small turbo is very, very vocal. It's a very vocal turbo. They like to make a lot of noise, and I like that. Now the Supra really isn't known for its corner carving abilities. It looks on the outside like a big giant cruiser. It's more so known for getting tuned into oblivion and running like sixes in the quarter mile. But it actually handles very well for its size. Again, it looks really large from the outside, and the interior cabin, the front seats anyways, is actually pretty roomy, but it doesn't feel, it drives smaller. It doesn't feel like you're driving a missile. And I'm sure that massive, sexy wing on the back kind of plays a part in the good handling. And so is this car's F1 derived ABS braking system, a system that allowed individual braking of every single caliper on their own based off sensors that read factors such as the speed and the angle and the pitch of oncoming corners. And this Supra's also riding on OEM Bilstein struts. This thing is very easy to drive, but it feels very mechanical, and I love that. You feel a little clank with every shift, and I wish I could say the same about the clutch, but that's brand new, so that's smooth as butter. And I mean, it's by no means silent in here, but it's pretty quiet. It's very comfortable, which I think is a common thread in these 90s Japanese sports cars. They were luxury cruisers as well as sports cars. Now, on the books, a factory Mark IV Supra does 0 to 60 in a little over 4.5 seconds. Pretty quick, and actually the same 0 to 60 time as a base C5 Corvette. But surprisingly, this thing has a pretty impressive quarter mile time at 13 seconds. An SRT8 Challenger does the quarter mile in like 13 seconds. This feels relatively fast. It feels like a 300 horsepower car would, but it's by no means like lightning. And you feel the turbos kick in, especially the secondary, but it's really not as fast as it's hyped up to be. Maybe that's because every time someone sees one of these things, they're tuned to the moon and they have 700, 800, 900 horsepower. But for what this thing lacks in speed, it makes up for it tenfold in the special factor, in the way that it makes you feel when you drive it. The power of nostalgia just takes over, like, whoa, hey, I'm in a stock Mark IV Supra. This is awesome. Like, I get why people tune the shit out of these things, but in stock form, this is a very good and a very solid car. Again, not great at anything, not great at any particular thing. It's a well-rounded, solid car. And I love it. Once again, massive shout out to my friends over at Northeast Auto Imports for allowing me to review this 1993 Toyota Supra. Probably the only bone stock one that I will ever get my hands on. I am blessed. Subscribe if you haven't. Help me hit 100,000 subscribers before the end of this year. And check out my Instagram at DriveHub__ for updates before YouTube. But I will see you guys in the next one. Happy motoring.